voice of American music and a master storyteller. Through his prolific career, John has written more than 20 top 40 hits, including, you all know most of these, Jack and Diane, Small Town, Crumbling Down, The Authority Song, Rain on the Scarecrow, Lonely All Night, R.O.C.K. in the USA, Paper and Fire, Check It Out, Pink Houses, Pop Singer, and Jackie Brown, to name some. His iconic American songs have played an important role in defining Midwestern music and developing the rock genre. John is a member of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, a Grammy winner, a recipient of the John Steinbeck Award, ASCAP Foundation's Champion Award, the Woody Guthrie Award, and the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers prestigious Founders Award, and he will be inducted into the Songwriters Hall of Fame this June. The social activism reflected in his songs helped Farm Aid, the concert series and organization that has addressed the struggle of American family farmers for more than 25 years. Did any of you see John perform one of his latest songs, Easy Target, on The Late Show with Stephen Colbert last week? You need to watch it. It delivers a powerful message regarding America's current political atmosphere, and John has never shied away from standing up for what he believes in, including social injustice. So back in 2003, Trouble No More started as an inside look at the recording of his new album, but it transformed to include an additional theme when the Iraq War started midway through the filming. I recall being in John's studio as he recorded To Washington, an adaptation of a 1930 Carter Family song, Cannonball Blues, that had also been rewritten by Woody Guthrie as a commentary about poverty. John's version provided an opportunity to voice his feelings about the war. He decided to put To Washington on his website, and his web manager said, it was like a rocket taking off, and it added to the national debate about the war. John then decided to create a music video for the song. So on a chilly March morning, he and I were walking around on his property, looking for a location to film the video. And in the distance on Lake Monroe, someone shouted from a small boat, there he is. John ignored it, but shortly after we heard, he's flying an American flag. It wasn't meant to be flattering. And it was easy to sense John's frustration. If I could have read his mind, I'm sure he was wondering why anyone could consider it unpatriotic for him to fly the flag. One of my favorite lines from Trouble No More was when John said, in my way of thinking, it's a very pro-American song. And as a songwriter, it's my responsibility to report the news as we see it. Besides his music, John continues to focus on another facet of his artistic expression, painting. His style has progressed over the years as evidenced by gallery and museum shows and published portfolios. He was also involved with an extraordinary collaboration for the Ghost Brothers of Darkling County. I'm sure some of you saw it when I was here. A musical with music and lyrics by John, a libretto by author Stephen King, and production by T-Bone Burnett. So as a documentary filmmaker, it's special to have an opportunity to include an artist or a musician in the creative process. From the Ashes filmmaker, Michael Bonfiglio, was fortunate to have John record Dark as a Dungeon for this documentary. That's special, and to be honest, I'm envious. So let's please give a warm welcome to John Mellencamp.
This isn't what I do. generally not in this situation. You people are probably wondering, why does John have a cane on him? Well, your conclusion, whatever it is wrong. Whatever you think is wrong. Men used to always carry walking sticks. Why? Does anybody know why men carried walking sticks? Huh?
Protection.
For protection. Why did men stop carrying walking sticks? Because there was an invention called the car. They didn't need to protect their loved ones and their families. My grandfather used to tell me, who was from old school, he would go, John, I was walking down the street in 1974 with him in New York City, and he said, you don't have your stick with you. I said, Grandpa, people don't carry sticks anymore. But he had his, and he also had a razor in his shoe. He asked me if I had my razor. I said, no, I don't carry a razor. People don't do that anymore. My point is that the world for him was pivoting. And that's what's happening to our world right now. We are in a pivot. My dad used to wait for the coal train to go by when he was a kid growing up in a little town in southern Indiana, and he would wait for the coal train to go by, and the coal would rattle off, and he would pick up the coal, him and his brothers and sisters, and that's how they heated their house, by what had fallen off the coal train. So once upon a time, coal was a necessary situation that people had to have. Today, not so much. We are pivoting. Pivoting means staying on one foot and remembering what you know, but looking the other way and having focus on what is in front of you. Now, I hear, you know, you hear a lot about, particularly from this administration, we're going to bring coal back. Why? Are we going to bring the walking stick back? Do we need the walking stick for protection? No. If you walk around with this fucking thing today, they'd be in jail. Which is probably the same thing they should do with the people who manufacture coal, is put them in jail. And you're going to say, well, what about the poor coal miners? Yeah, what about them? They have been treated miserably their entire life. Nobody's saying a word that everybody at Sears and Roebuck and Kmart are going out of business. JCPenney's, what about those people? Where are they supposed to work? The coal industry needs to realize that they're done, and the rest of the world is pivoting. We have an administration who is trying to make America great again. And if that means polluting the atmosphere with carbon monoxide and you name it, then that's going backwards. At FarmAid, we talk about sustainable agriculture. If you guys were going to buy a TV, you would do research on that TV. If you're going to buy a car, you would do research on the car. You would say, how many miles to the gallon? How long can I anticipate this car lasting? How many pixels are on this TV set? You would do a lot of research about what you're getting ready to purchase. But you walk into a grocery store and you'll eat any shit that they lay in front of you. You don't care, you don't know. I'm the same way. I walk into the grocery store and I take their word for it. I take their word that there's only so many grams of fat, and it's just like, we need to pivot. keep what we know, but start looking through a different lens. And the future is not coal. The future is not coal. I've seen this movie, I've seen this documentary, I know the people who made this movie. Bloomberg's heart is in the right place. The people that work for Bloomberg are in the right place. Even though this administration has done many things to destroy what was done before, Bloomberg has come forward with other mayors and other governors and said, we don't care what's going on in Washington. We're going to continue to do what's correct and correct for America and our future. So that's about all I've got to say on the topic. I got a lot more to say, but that's all I'm worried about. So when you see a guy walking with a cane, don't think you know there's something wrong with his leg. I just walked in here from the car and I had three people go, what happened to you? Nothing. You just misread you made an assumption that was wrong. And the assumptions that we all make every day in our life, I have found out at 66, are generally wrong. If I make an assumption without researching it, I'm probably not going to be right. So I hope you guys enjoy the film. I know you will. I've seen it. It's interesting. You'll learn something. You may not agree with everything that's being said, but again, Bloomberg has got his foot going in the right direction, and he is pivoting. And I hope you guys can pivot along with us. Thank you.
Awesome.